Today's daf is Daf Yud Dalet, Daf Yud Dalet. We're starting from Daf Yud Gimel Amar Aleph by Neima. But maybe we should review the Machlokes over here. If you look at the screen, you have here over here a typical wheat. You have the straw, which is called the Yad, and then the beard, which contains the kernel. And what we're discussing over here is that in Tumah, if you just pick this straw and a sheretz, let's say, touches the yad, then the rest of the wheat becomes tame because the yad is connected to the rest of the wheat. Same thing with the grape. If you touch the stem of a grape, the stem would be called the yad, and the yad would carry the tumah from the stem to the grape itself. Okay, that's simple. And actually, there's a mesechta in Mishnayos that deals with Yodos. It's actually not called Yadayim. It's called Mesechtas Uktzim, the Mesechta about the stems. Anyway, so our Gemara, we're going to go back and just look quickly what Rav Abba said. Rav Abba said in the name of Rav Huna, Haboitzer Legas, and we'll see how it gets in to our sugya of Mesechta Sukkah. Haboitzer Legas, someone who cuts grapes, and he just wants to use the grapes for wine. So he doesn't want the handle. He's not selling the grapes. He doesn't need the yad. So the din is ein lo yadas, yadois. We don't look at, the yadois don't exist. In other words, there's no din yadayim on it. And therefore, it's almost as if it's separated right now. And if you touch if a tumah would touch the stem, it wouldn't be mitama the grape, because you want the grape for use of wine. You don't even need the stem. So that's one, a simple din. V'Rab Menashe Bar Gada Amar Rav Huna said, HaKoitzer L'Schach, if you cut wheat, that wheat over there, and you tend to just use it for schach, right? Now, you could use it for schach because straw and most of this piece of wheat is non-edible, and therefore non-edible thing that grows from the ground that's not makabel tumah could be used for schach. The edible part is the kernel inside, which is the wheat. So he says that hakoitzer l'schach, if you cut wheat with your intention to use the wheat as schach, ein lo yodos, then the wheat is not considered a connection to the kernel. So in other words, once you cut it in a certain way, you automatically said to everyone that you don't even need the kernel of wheat inside. In fact, the kernel of wheat is detrimental because you can't really use the kernel of wheat for schach because it's a food item. So therefore, ein lo yodos. Once you cut the wheat in that way, if a tumah would touch the stem or the straw, the kernel would not become tame because you cut it not for food, but you cut it to use as schach. So the Gemara said, Manda om koitzer, the one that said this chiddush by schach, cutting wheat, kol shkein boitzer, he would also agree to the case of the grapes. The lo nichale, the lo nimtzai lechamrei. He doesn't want stems to go into his chamrei, is his wine. So therefore, of course, but man the umber, according to the opinion, boitzer ein lo yadis, the one that only gave the example by the grapes, avo koitzer, but the cutting of wheat for schach, he will hold gesh lo yadis, then it does connect. Why? Really, you don't need, the kernel is detrimental to be used as schach. Why would he not agree to the other man the umber? The nichale the schach abei. He really wants the kernel to be in the wheat stalk when he puts it up of schach. Why? Kiheicha deloy lebadram. When you have the wheat kernel inside the stalk will not easily float, fly away in the wind. So it adds a certain weight dimension to this wheat. And therefore, we would consider in this case, even if you cut this piece of wheat for schach, we would consider it, yadayim, and therefore, if the tumah would touch the straw, the kernel would become tame. So that's the machlekes. Again, one holds cutting wheat. What cutting wheat? Ein lo yodais, right? The cutting wheat, hakoitzer l'schach, as Rav Menashe holds, cutting wheat, there's no yadayim. Rav Abba holds, by wheat, there is yadayim. So let us see. Name of the Rav Menashe bar Gada Tanohi. According to Rav Menashe, who said that cutting wheat, there is no yadayim, maybe that's a machlokes tanoim. The Tanya, we learned in a brisa, soichei te'enim, the branches of figs, uvehen te'enim, that have figs on it. Parpile, parkilin is grape stems, uvehen banovin, you have grapes on them. Kashu is straw, uvehen shibolim, it has the bearded part with the wheat. Machpedois are branches of palm trees, uvehen tamarim, that have dates. Kulam, so it's talking about tzchach, ipsoilis mrubal oichlan, if there's more stem and stuff on it, then kasheri, you could use it as chach, because you ignore the fruit part of it, because most of the what's going to be used as a schach is the unedible part. And if there's more unedible part, then it's kosher for schach. Mimla, pesula, and if not, it's possible. But acherim oimim, Rabbi Cherim say, by the wheat, ache kashem meruba al yodos v'ala oichlem. That means that for schach, the part has to be, the straw part has to be more than the handle and the food item. In other words, if you're going to use this straw as your schach, you have to allow an inch or two to be the handle, like over here, you'll stop it. And this part, the straw part, has to be more than the food itself, the kernel itself, plus a little part for the handle. Because it seems that acherim hold, ein lo yadayim. When you cut wheat for schach is ein lo yadayim. My love, won't you say, b'hokami palgi? This is the argument. The Marsova, the Tanakama holds, yesh lehem yadayim. There is yadayim for wheat. Marsova, the other man, the Omar, holds, that's a cherim holds, yesh lo yadayim. But Marsova, but the Tanakama holds, ein lehem yadayim. If you cut wheat for schach, there's no concept of yadayim anymore. And that is the machlekes. So when you say that it's a machlekes tanoim, so the Gemara answers, Lirababa, Bade Tanoi. According to Rabbi Abba, who holds that if you cut wheat, Ein Loi, there is no Yodois. If you cut wheat, Yesh Loi Yodois, there is Yodois. Rabbi Abba will say it's Machlekes Tanoim. And I hold like Acherim, that Acherim holds you have to give off a little bit for Yadayim, for a handle of the wheat. So I hold like the Acherim. Rav Nasha Bargada, Rav Nasha held that nobody should hold that there's yodois by wheat. Mileme tanoi, would you have to say that this also is a machlekes tanoi? So, because in other words, how would Rav Nasha align himself with Acherim, who says that there is yodois by wheat? Rav Nasha says there is no yodois by wheat. Amalach Rav Nasha, Rav Nasha says, the kuli alma sovri, everybody will hold. If you're cutting wheat to use a schach, there is no yodos, there is no handle. And here we're talking about, and this is the reason why the acherim hold that there is yodos. In this case, why? You first cut the wheat to eat. Oh, if you cut it first to eat, then there is yodos, because that's the way you handle the piece of a wheat to take it to the threshing floor and to process it. So if you cut it, originally you cut it for achila. And then while it's out there, v'nimlach aleim nesikach, then in your mind, you changed your mind to make use of tzchach. Oh, so you only changed it in your mind. So that's why the acherim hold, since you originally cut it for achila and you tried to change it just in your mind for tzchach, it doesn't work. And therefore, in this particular case, the wheat will have a din of yodos. So the Gemara asks the question. Then according to the Rabbanan that say, Ein lo yodos, they hold, you could change your mind. With your mind, you could actually undo something. If you cut something for eating purposes, what's the reason of the Rabbanan that hold Ein lo yodos? Why? Will you say, the Rabbanan will hold, Kevod, since you changed your mind to use it as chach, so originally you cut it for achila, that's why yesh lo yodos. Now that you changed your mind to use for schach, it removes the concept of yodos, but lele machshavta, you could nullify your original intention. Wait a second. V'chi bot lele machshava b'achi, can you nullify your original intention? If you have intention to use something, and then you change your mind, you can't. Your intention cannot undo your original intention. Let's give the example. Atnan, let's take this example. Kol HaKelim, if you're making, let's say, a leather something or another, you have a big piece of leather and you're making it for something. Let's go to the top of Yudalad Amar Aleph. Yardin le'tumah b'machshava. If you think about it, you can make it susceptible to tumah. See, as long as you don't finish a leather product, obviously it's not makabel tumah. But you can decide early on in the process that you want to use it as a tablecloth. So once you decide in your mind that you want to use it as a tablecloth, it's makabel tumah, it's susceptible to tumah. Then if you change your mind, say, you know what, I want to make a pair of shoes out of that, well, that means you didn't finish the, according to the second thought, you didn't even finish the process of making the product. So, but once you originally made a machshava that you want to finish your work and you want to make it as a tablecloth, so be'ein oilim mitumosim elo b'shinu ma'asa. You can only undo that only if you do an action, a physical action to the product to show that you're making shoes out of it. Like you say, you start brushing it or do something, but your mind alone can't change your original intention. So as the Braisa gives you, the Mishnah gives you the klolim. An action can undo a previous action or a previous thought. Machshava, but a thought, if you want a second thought on something, Eina cannot undo loy miyad maisa, not an original action, loy miyad machshava regarding an original thought. So once you have a thought about something, and it makes something susceptible to tuma, you can't undo it with another second thought. Same thing. So let's say the same thing by yodos. If you originally cut this piece of wheat to use as food, then it has yodos just by in your mind's thought that you want to now use it for schach, doesn't undo the yad problem. The yad situation still remains because a machshava, a thought, cannot undo an original thought. So that's what the Mishnah says. So how could the Rabbanan hold that there is no yadais over here? V'chi teima, will you say, hani mili b'keilim d'chashivi, when it comes to making items, useful items, like the leather tablecloth or the leather shoes, the chashivi, that's an important thing. So therefore you need another action to undo a thought. Ava yadais, addition, handles for a keili, or for food, that's for food, you can decide with your thought that you want to use it for food, and with a thought, you could undo the process by having another thought. In other words, food items may be different than kalim. With food items, you can decide that you're using it for food, and therefore it has yadais. And with food, you could say, you know what, I don't want to use it for food, because for food, you can go back and forth. But kalim, once you decide to make something into a keli, that's more chashiv, and therefore, once you thought that this is your end of the process, you can't undo that, and it becomes susceptible to tumah right away. So the Mishnah said, if that's true, that food is different. But now we learned in the Mishnah, kol yadois ha'oichlim, any handles of food. Again, let's say the handle of a piece of wheat, right? Shebesoson, you did besoson. Bagoyren, you did something in the goyren. What does besasa mean? We'll define it in a moment. If you did this besasan, tahoris, then it becomes tahoris because besasan is an action. So it could be an action, or is it a thought? Bishloma lamandama besasan. It explains very well that if you translate besasan to mean hitir igudan, that you just untied it. In other words, when you brought it into the granary. It was tied and you untie it. You didn't do anything with the stems, with the straw. That is just a thought process that undoes what you want to, what your original intention was to use it as food, this wheat. Because you're untying it and you're just leaving it hanging. So that indicates your thought process that you don't want to use this wheat as food. So then the handles are tar. Sharper, then it makes sense because food can be you could undo the original thought of food by doing another thought because basasan is like a thought. According to the opinion that translated that Mishnah, that basasan means my basasan, basasan mamish, that you trampled, that you actually stepped on the handles, you actually stepped on the yadas. Imagine the piece of wheat and with all the others, and you stick your foot on it and you know, just trample on it. So that means that in order to undo your original thought to use this wheat as food, you actually have to do an action, a masa, to undo that thought. My ikala meima, what you're going to say. So in our case, by the case of the koitzis and lechtzach, why would the rabbanan hold that there is no yodos over here? So the Gemara answers the case of our Mishnah, of that original brisa with the rabbanim that argue on acherim shebesos on the mamish. It's talking about actually that a guy originally cut the wheat for food, then he trampled on the yodos, and that was an indication that he does not want to use the wheat as food. He wants to use it as chat, and therefore there is no din of yodos anymore. So if he trampled on it, why would Acherim argue? If he actually did a maisa, an action to undo his original thought, why would Acherim disagree and hold that there's still yeshli others? Answers the Gemara, the Amak Rabbi Yossi, because they hold like Rabbi Yossi. The Tanam we learned in the Mishnah. Rabbi Yossi metame. Rabbi Yossi still says, even after you trample the wheat and the straw, it still remains tame. So the Acherim hold like Rabbi Yossi that you still didn't undo the original thought for using it food just by trampling on it. So the Gemara says, Haimai, how can you compare? Bishlam Ahasam, by the case over there, where a guy brought wheat into his granary, he thought he was going to use it for food. Rabbi Yossi says that even if you trample on all the wheat, then you start trampling on the handles of the wheat, it doesn't undo it. It's still considered a food because time with Rabbi Yossi, because he says chazi elektor Rav Shimon ben Lakish, you could still use the handle of the piece of wheat because the way Rav Shlakish explains, the Amar Rav Shlakish ben Lakish, hoil ruuyas lahoivchem be'eser, since you can actually turn over, it makes it easier to like shovel out with a pitchfork. And therefore, since you can turn over these grains, the wheat grains with a pitchfork, so the fact is you still want the handle of that piece of wheat. Elahacha, but over here, but you're putting the wheat onto the schach, onto your sukkah, the maichazia. Why would you still need the handle to be connected to the beer, to the other part? You still don't care. And for the Gemara, it's still needed. When you take apart the sukkah, it's much easier to have the handle connected to the piece of wheat. So it's easier to remove the schach when sukkah is over to take it apart. So this almost ends that sugya. Basically, what we learned over here is one simple din. If you cut a piece of wheat for schach, right? So you cut it, you could use it for schach because it's mostly unedible food. But in Hilchas Tumah, if a sheretz would touch this part, the yad, the straw part, would the kernel become tame? According to the Tanakama, according to one mandiyama, it's a machlekes tanoim, and according to another mandiyama, it's not a machlekes tanoim, and everybody will hold ein lo yodos. There is no yodos over here. In other words, it would not transmit tumah. The only time it would transmit tumah is if you cut it for food. Even if you changed your mind, it's possible that it would still be mekabel tumah. Let's just finish up this Gemara. It's again, we've seen this over countless times, that whenever we bring up a Mishnayis in Masechta Taharis, since there is no Gemara in Taharis, we just elaborate a little bit on it. And that's what we say. Gufo, we learned in the Mishnah. And I point out to you, if you learn Rashi, Rashi writes a very interesting thing over here. Rashi writes, the Gufo word doesn't make sense. He writes about 3-4 lines from the wide line. Sha'alti es moiri. I asked my teacher, how could you write Mugufa? Gufa in a Mishnah, over here, it's not saya, it doesn't make sense to word gufa. Gufa is usually when you had a teaching from a statement of an amoira. Gufa, this amoira said this, therefore let's elaborate on this. Why do we use gufa on a Mishnah? And my Rebbe told me, because since this Mishnah is Matiris and there's no Gemara, so it's therefore the Talmud could use Gufo. But you see the humility of Rashi when he wrote his Pirish on the Gemara, that he tells you that this thing I asked my Rebbe. Gufo, so this teaching was in a Mishnah. Kol yadoisa oichlin shibosis on begarim. If you have a handle of a garim, you cut the wheat for use as food, but you did basasan, you trampled at them. Or what is basasan begarim? Tahiris, it's tahar. Rabbi Yossi metame. Rabbi Yossi says it's tame, and the Gemara explains by basasan. What does it mean basasan? Rabbi Yochanan amar basasan mamish. You actually trampled on them. That's the machloekis. If you trampled on them, Rabbi Lezer I may hit their agdam. It's just untie the wheat. The Gemara says, Bishlama l'Rab Elazar d'Ama Basusan Mamish Mehitir Agadon. So now I understand Hainu the Mitame Rabbi Yossi. That's why Rabbi Yossi says it's Tame, because you're only, if you just untie it, that's just like a thought. And Rabbi Yossi holds a thought can't undo an original thought that you want to use it as food. So that's why Rabbi Yossi says it's tame. Ela Rabbi Yochanan da'amar basasa mamish amai mitame. Rabbi Yossi, if according to Rabbi Yochanan, the word basasa means you actually stepped on it, so why would Rabbi Yochanan say? Why would Rabbi Yossi say it's that you still have a yad over here and it remains tame? Why? You trampled on it. You showed you don't want that connection between the handle of the wheat and the wheat kernel itself. You still want it. In deep down, you still want it because it's still easier to transport because you could, you know, shift it around with a pitchfork. And then the Gemara ends with a piece of Agadita. Amar Rab Lazar says, Lama nimshala tefilasun shel tzadikin ke'aser. Why are the prayers of the righteous are compared to a pitchfork? We find that in the Torah. Vayetar Yitzhak Lashem. When Yitzchak was praying for a child, so they were praying with the word eser. So what is eser? Why is a tefillah called a pitchfork? It's teaching you that the power of prayer. A pitchfork can transport or turn around wheat from place to place. It could turn it around and actually move it from place to place. Af tefillasan shel tzadikim, the prayers of a righteous person, mehapechas daitel shel Kadosh Baruch Hu, could turn God's mind around, memidis achzorius, from being cruel, so to speak, memidis rachmanius, to the midah of compassion. So that's how powerful it can really turn something around, and rather quickly, like as fast as a pitchfork can turn around wheat. New Mishnah, back into discussion of sukkah. Mesachichim b'nesorim. Mesachichim b'nesorim. You allow to put schach using boards, divrei Rabbi Yehuda. So let's take a look at the picture. This is the picture. The picture is you have boards, wide planks, so to speak, as schach. So Rabbi Yehuda holds you could use planks as schach. Rameir oiser. We have this, Rameir says it's not permitted. Now, why would Rameir say it's not permitted? Why would it say, L'chaira, these are pieces of wood, they're planks of wood, but they're just a little bit wide. So there is a gezeira, according to Rameir, and we'll see that maybe Rabbi Yehuda agrees with that, is that if you put up planks like that, that's how they made houses. Regular house was made like this. Imagine a regular house in ancient times. And therefore, when you put up planks to build a permanent house, that's not a sukkah. It's possible as a sukkah, even if it's kosher. All this is kosher material, but the fact you put it up, not for a temporary dwelling, but you put it for a permanent dwelling, it's possible. It's possible. It cannot be used for schach. It cannot be used for a sukkah. So even if you put it up, since most people, when they put up these planks, build it for houses, even if you would put it up for a schach, the Rabbanan said it would be invalid because people will think that you're allowed to use homes as sukkahs. That's what it was. So Rameir says it's usher, even if you put it up as schach. Then the Mishnah ends off, Nosan alea nesa shuhu rachav aba tvachim. You put a plank, one plank that's four tvachim, and let's assume that the plank that is four tefachim, you put it right by the wall. So right by one kosher wall, right by the wall. It's a kosher sukkah, but right by one kosher wall, the first part of the schach is this plank that's four tefachim. So ksheira, then the whole sukkah is still kosher because the plank is considered as if part of the wall, and we saw this before. It's called doifin akuma, where the wall twists and turns and becomes roof. So it's really all part of one wall. The sukkah begins beyond that. So therefore, it's kashera. It's a kosher sukkah. Vachlo yishin tachtav. Don't sleep under that plank that had four tefachim in it, because that's part of the wall. That's not part of the schach. Let's see if he has it over here. Here we have it. This is the picture. You have one plank over here. So we view this wall as if it curves. So this plank is part of the wall. Don't sleep under it, but the rest of the sukkah is kosher. That's the Mishnah. Says the Gemara. Amar Rav. Rav explained the beginning of the machlokes. Machlokes b'nesorim sheyesh ben abo'o. The machlokes between Rabbi Yehuda and Rabbi Meir is if the board has four tefachim and more. It's a real wide board. The Rameir is the gzeiras tikra. Rameir holds that we have a gzeira of tikra, of a real roof that people used in homes. So most people use the roof of their homes with wide planks. So therefore, even if you put it up with your intention to make a sukkah, Chazal said it's no good because people will think if you build a house, that's also a kosher sukkah. Rabbi Yehuda, less leg gzeiras tikra. Rabbi Yehuda does not hold of the gzeira of the house. That's called gzeiras tikra. The gzeira that you might think you're allowed to have a sukkah in your house. Rabbi Yehuda doesn't hold of that gzeira. Aval but b'nesarim she'ein behem abar. If you have a planks that don't have four tefachim, divrei hakol kosher. Everybody would agree it's kosher. If you have a small plank, let's say it's a small. Let's say it's three tefachim, two tefachim, it doesn't matter. Even Rameo would agree it's kosher. That's chach. So that makes sense. But Shmuel Amar, Shmuel says something interesting. Even if it didn't have four tefachim, let's say it had three tefachim. So then there's still a machlokes. Rabbi Yehuda says it's good. The planks are good. It's a good sukkah. And Rabbi Anan said it's not, and Rabbi Meir says it's not a good sukkah. Aval yesh behen abo, but if it has more than four tefachim, even Rabbi Yehuda would agree. Divrei al kol psula, everybody would agree it's possible, because Rabbi Yehuda would agree to the gezera of tikra. So the Gemara asks the question: Ein behem abo, if it doesn't have four tefachim, vafilu pachus mishloisha. That means even if it's less than three tefachim, let's say a schach has two tefachim. Would you say that there is a machlokes by that Rabbi Meir would still say that if the plank is just two tefachim wide, it's no good? Why would Rabbi Meir answer that? You know, the typical bamboo is maybe wider than that in some cases. Hakanim ba'almaninu, that's just like reeds. Reeds are a little bit wide, and if they're less than three tefachim, so then certainly it should be kosher. Well, how could Rabbi Meir argue on that point? So Amar Apapa, Rapapa said, and Rapapa is coming to explain what Shmuel meant. Hachi Kamar, this is what Shmuel meant. Shmuel's opinion is, Yesh behen abar. If you have a plank that has four tefachim or more, Divrei HaKol Psula, both Rabbi Meir and Rabbi Yehuda would say it's possible. Pachos Mishloisha, but if it's less than three, Divrei HaKol Kashera. Everybody would agree it's kosher because like a bamboo sticks or reeds or whatever, it could be less than three tefachim. My timer, konim ba'almoni. That's like regular reed. Regular schach can be small, thin rods. Keep ligi, the argument between Rabbi Meir and Rabbi Yehuda is mishaloisha adabar. If you have a plank that's three tefachim, but up until four tefachim. So, mar sova, Rabbi Yehuda holds, kaven de lisnayu shi'ur mokon, since it's less than four tefachim, less than something that's less than four tefachim doesn't really count so much in halacha. Remember, shusha yochid has to be at least four tefachim. So if something takes up a space of less than four tefachim, so Rabbi Yehuda said, loy gazrinim, they never made the gzeiras tikra over there by something that's less than four tefachim. So even if it's three plus, it still wouldn't be under the gzera. Only if it's four tefachim or more, then it falls under the gzera of tikra. And even Rabbi Huda would agree that it's not good. Omar Sava, but one holds, kaven the nafkalu mataris lovid gazrina. Rabbi Meir holds that even three tefachim has dimensions in halacha when it comes to the concern of lovid. Remember, lovid means we consider it connected. That means if you have a space between your schach of less than three tefachim, we automatically consider the schach connected, right? Lovin means you connect things together beyond, when it's less than three tefachim. But when it's more than three tefachim, we don't say it's connected. So an ear space in a sukkah that's more than three tefachim is considered separate. It's a considered an interruption in your sukkah. So therefore, three tefachim in Chazal have a dimension to it. And therefore, if the plank, according to Rabbi Meir, is greater than three tefachim, gazrinam, then we make the gezerah of gezerah's tikra, and so you cannot eat in that sukkah. It's not a valid plank to be used as chach. Tanan, we learned in the Mishnah. Now we just examined this. Tanan, we learned in the Mishnah. Nosan olea nehaseh shu rochav abot tefachim kshera. The person puts a plank that's wide for tefachim, it's kshera, it's kosher. That's what the Mishnah says. Uvavad shlo yishan tachtiv. Don't sleep under it. So this is this case over here. The Mishnah says, if you put a plank that's four tefachim, and the Mishnah says the word four tefachim, don't sleep under here. Now, it seems to be that everybody agrees to this opinion. So the Gemara asks, Bishlam l'Shmuel, according to Shmuel, the Amar b'sh'ein behem ha'abach machlekes, if it's less than four, that's when they have a machlekes between Reb Yehuda and Reb Meir. But if it's greater than four tefachim, divri hakol psula, everybody would agree it's possible. So even Rabbi Huda would agree it's possible. Mishum hachi, that's why the Mishnah says if it has four tefachim, lo yishan tachan, don't sit under it, because everybody agrees don't sleep in it, don't eat there. That's not sukkah. That's not part of the sukkah. You have to move towards the bamboos. Ela l'Rav, but according to Rav, according to Rabbi Huda, this should be good, because Rabbi Yehuda holds anything, there's never a gzeres tikra. According to Rav, the way Rabbi Yehuda learns, imagine a sukkah looking like this. According to the way the Rav learns, this is kosher schach, according to Rav, explaining Rabbi Yehuda. So according to Rav, how do you explain the end of the Mishnah, that Mishnah says that if it's four tefachim, don't sleep under here? That's what the Gemara, Elad Rav, the Oma, B'yishmei Machlekes. And even if it's greater than four, Rabbi Yehuda says it's permitted. If it doesn't have four, that was Rabbi's opinion. The Rabbi Yehuda, according to Rabbi Yehuda, why should you sleep under it? That's kosher schach, according to Rabbi Yehuda, the way Rav explained it. And says to Gemara, mi savret divi akolhi, do you hold the end of the Mishnah according to Rav is an anonymous statement by everyone, Rabbi Meir and Rabbi Yehuda? Seifen asan Rabbi Meir. The Seifen is expressing Rabbi Meir's viewpoint. It's just elaborating, according to Rabbi Meir, that four tefachim is already a problem. If it's on the side wall, don't sleep under it. Nu Gemara, Tashma, Shnei Sedinim Mitzdarfin. Let's return to Amit Pcheni, Shnei Nisarim Eina Mitzdarfin. We have two, if you have this picture over here, you have the Mishnah says, the Brisa says, according to the Tanakam, which is Rabbi Yehuda, you have two rolls of linen sheets, okay? That's three tefachim, less than three tefachim. They could passel your sukkah, because if it's less, they have more than four tefachim. So then you have schach passel. Now you have to remember a very important point throughout the Masechta Sukkah. Very important point. If you have an ear space over here in your sukkah, right? Let's say you have an ear space. There's nothing here. Then three tefachim will invalidate your sukkah. Three tefachim. But once you put on schach pasul schach, then you need four tefachim. You get a little extra space. You get four tefachim. You have schach pasul, then you need four tefachim to pasul your sukkah. So if you have two, you know, sheets of paper, sheets of linen over here, they pasul your sukkah if you take them together and they're more than four tefachim. But the Brisa says that if there's two boards over here, they don't combine to pasul your sukkah. That's the first statement. And that's Rabbi Yehuda's statement. Rabbi Meir, Oyma, Af Nesorim Kisadim. The Nesorim, the boards, combine itself like the sheets, and they will passel your sukkah. So the Gemara says, Bishlam al Shmuel, everything makes perfect sense according to Shmuel, the Amar, B'she'e behen b'ha abo machlekes. When there is no four, there is a machlekes. Aviyesh behen abo d'vayakal psula, if it's more than four, everybody agrees, psula. My mitzdarfin, what does it mean mitzdarfin? Mitzdarfin la'abo. It combines to four. In other words, the way Rabbi Yishmuel explained the machlekes, it's very easy to understand this case, what would be the machlekes between Rabbi Meir and Rabbi Yehuda. Since Rabbi Yehuda holds that these three, that these boards are, this is like three tvachim, right? Let's call it three and three. It thinks each one of them is kosher for schach, right? Because three tvachim is kosher. Therefore, they don't combine to pasul yasukah because each one by definition is kosher for schach. Each one is kosher for schach. And Rabbi Meir holds three already is a pas is non-kosher schach. And therefore, they combine to pasul yisukah, not alone, but they combine because it has to be four tefachim. It combines to create a pasul schach space of four tefachim, and therefore, a mayor holds yischach is pasul. So the brisa makes perfect sense to be explained according to Shmuel. El Rav, according to Rav, v'yesh behem abo machlokes. If Rav said that Rav Yehuda never pasul the schukah, he says the board could be as big as you want. There's no that Rabbi Yehuda says it's permitted, and only Rabbi Yehuda and Rabbi Meir says it's not permitted. Alva Abraham Abar, if it's less than four, Divya Kol Kshera, everybody would agree it's kosher. Hey Chidami, how would you explain that brisa? Eid is Fuhu Arba, if there's four tfachim over there, Lama Lulitz Terufe. Why do you need to combine anything? If it has four tfachim or more, why would Rabbi Meir say, oh, I needed to combine to pasul the sukkah. If this piece over here, according to you explaining, had four tefachim, Rameya says it's pasul. If you combine it, what do you mean? You don't need to combine it. By the fact that it's four tefachim, it already is a pasul schach. And either less luhubaba, if it has less than four tefachim, then everybody agrees it's kosher. Amai, why Rameya say it's no good? Well, hakana ba'almani, it's actual read. So according to Rav, this Bryce is unexplainable. And so the Gemara, Oilam the Ismail Abba, Umay Mitzdarfim, Mitzdarfim, Abba Abbas Mitzdarf. Really, it has four tfachim. And what it means is, let's say if they have the picture, is that here it is, that really it has four tfachim. And it has four tfachim. And we know that Doifin Akuma, this is to be counted as part of the wall, it has to be within four amas of the wall. To be counted as if you have a crooked wall. So therefore, what Rameir is saying here is that if you have a four tfachim schach over here, if this is four tfachim, then when you count all these four tfachim are pasul schach. It's like a concrete roof. And this four tfachim is the first one after combining all this. So this one will pasul your sukkah because you don't say doifin akuma anymore. According to Rabbi Yehuda, since four tfachim is kosher schach, this is all kosher schach according to Rabbi Yehuda. And this is the way Rav will explain that brisa. That brisa is talking about doifin akuma, and according to Rabbi Yehuda, this is all kosher schach, so you don't even need doifin akuma. These are all kosher schach and it's permitted. According to Rabbi Meir, since these are four planks of four tefachim each. Each one of them is like a pasul eschach, but you could all consider them as part of the wall. So then the one after that will be the first one that's pasul, will invalidate your schokah. One more line, and that's it, and we'll stop. Lishna achrina, another way to examine the kasha on the brisa that you said this brisa makes sense according to Shmuel and it does not make sense according to Rav. Bishlam al Shmuel da Amar she'ein behem abo machlokes aviyesh behem abo d'vayakal psula umay mitzdarfim la'abo abas min atzad. According to Shmuel, I can explain this brisa that it's talking about doifin akuma, and what is it talking about? It's talking about planks that have less than three, that's three or more. And therefore, you can explain it the same way. According to Rav Meir, you have the Doifin Akuma ends over here. The Doifin Akuma would end over here. Imagine, according to the way Shmuel explains it, everything has three. And therefore, the Doifen Akuma ends over here, and therefore, this would be your first Pasul Schach that would invalidate your sukkah because you have too much of a Doifen Akuma over here, too much of a wall. That makes sense according to the way Ravel explained to it. But according to Ella Larav, you can't explain this by according to Rameya, the reason why it's usher, it's because you combine it and you have four amas mitzad, and that's why each one is puzzle. Ella Rabbi Huda, the ama afiliyash ben aba amas kseira, my aim mitzdarfin. Why does Rabbi Huda hold you don't combine it? Each one, according to Rabbi Huda, if it's four tfachim or bigger, certainly they are kosher schach. Rabbi Huda has unlimited size to the width of schach. So on this, the Gemara answers, I did the Kamer Rabbeya Mitzdarfin, Kamer Rabbi Huda, Amar Rabbi Huda Mitzdarfin. Since Rabbi Huda used the word Mitzdarfin, Rabbi Huda uses the word Ein Mitzdarfin. So we'll stop over here. What you have to remember is three basic halachas, very important halachas. One halacha is, quickly, is how wide can this be? How wide can a plank be? According to, it depends. According to the way Rav explained, Rabbi Huda says there's no limit. It could be very wide. And Rabbi Meir says, no, if it's four and above, it's usher. Rabbi Shmuel will say, no, everybody agrees if it's very wide, it's no good. If the Mechlekes was between three and four. And we discussed a little bit about Doifen Akuma, but one thing to remember, that for Pasel Schach to invalidate a sukkah, it has to be four tfachim to invalidate a sukkah. For ear, if it was just no schach, just plain ear, it invalidates only if already by three tfachim. By Pasel Schach, you need four tfachim, and by Doifen Akuma, you need four amas. And more than four
hours
to be not part of the
world. Bernard, I just have a quote. That's the thing I don't understand. When you're saying puzzle schach, you need four, meaning that four tfachim. Yeah, with the puzzle schach.
Right over here.
I thought, but wouldn't that, if you have a puzzle schach, you can't use anyone. What do you care if it's four or eight or 15? What does that matter?
No, but look at this sukkah over here. You have three walls over here in the sukkah. Mm-hmm. And therefore, if you passel the schach, so you only have two walls because this wall doesn't count for this mm-hmm. sukkah. So this part of the sukkah has no three walls, and this part of the sukkah has no three walls.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about a sukkah that has three walls. I'm sorry.
Right.
I didn't explain it. If you have a
sukkah. No, right. I see the three. Yeah, of course.
But because this, now you only have two walls. So therefore, that's why only. So we say if there was air space over here, already by three tfachim, it divides up the sukkah into two parts.
But by
Pasul Eschach, you need four tfachim to divide up a sukkah.
Oh, I understand because you're concerned about the wall. I got it. Okay.
But at one last point, if when it comes to Doifen Akuma, to say that this Pasul Eschach is part of the wall, you could say that up to four amas. You could say that a wall bends up to 8 feet.
Yeah.
You understand?
Yeah.
But beyond that, then it's not kosher. Beyond that, it's not kosher. So that's what we're saying over here. If you call this pasul schach, then this would be your first beyond four amas. But if this is kosher schach, then it's no problem.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Where will you be resuming?
Okay, yeah. I'm going to be resuming Tanya Kavose de Rav Yochanan. That's on Yudalad Amud Sheni, about like halfway down. Tanya Kavose de Rav. A proof to Rav and a proof to Shmuel. That's it.
I see. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Going back. It's very complicated, the Gemaras, but these are the Yesoidis of this Besakta.
Foundation.
Good night, everybody.
No.